So having not played a single Max Payne or Alan Wake game, I didn't quite know what to expect from Control, the latest title from Finnish game studio Remedy Entertainment. I'd seen a little bit of gameplay here and there anytime a trailer for the game would pop up on my social feed, but nothing more beyond that. But I can't say I was surprised when I finally played Control and found myself loving every minute of it. I knew Alan Wake and Max Payne were both beloved by fans of those series, so it made sense that Remedy would know how to make a solid game. What I didn't expect was how familiar Control felt, and I mean that in a good way. Control is a game in part about confronting the unknown. The protagonist, Jesse Faden, arrives at the doors of Control's oldest house looking for answers about the disappearance of her brother Dylan, who she believes was kidnapped by the Bureau when they were children. Dylan's disappearance is the big unknown in her life. But Jesse's journey into this unknown is just one of a sea of unknowns swirling around the Bureau. But Remedy doesn't fill the halls of the oldest house with mystery for mystery's sake. Everything propels the narrative forward. So as I was playing, I was reminded of a bit of writing advice I had read from the Expanse saga co-author Daniel Abraham. He says, "Never mistake confusion for suspense. What the hell is going on is almost always worse storytelling than, what the hell's going to happen next?" And though there were obviously plenty of times playing Control where I wondered what was going on, it was never at the expense of my greater interest in where the story was going. And I think there's a couple of neat ways the story of Control was written to avoid unnecessarily obfuscating the narrative with all of Control's supernatural mumbo-jumbo. Control writer and Remedy Entertainment co-founder Sam Lake, in an interview with Variety, revealed that the story of Control took inspiration in part from Alex Garland's 2018 film Annihilation. And game director Michael Kasurian went a step further in an interview with The Hollywood Reporter to say that the game took inspiration not only from Garland's interpretation of Annihilation, but from Annihilation author Jeff Vandermeer's whole Southern Reach trilogy. Both Remedy's Federal Bureau of Control and Vandermeer's Southern Reach are deeply hidden and covert government organizations. One could almost imagine them existing in the same universe, as each deal with the exploration and study of things and places beyond the scope of traditional science. The Southern Reach's primary method of study is expeditions into the enigmatic and ever-expanding Area X, dubbed the Shimmer in Garland's interpretation. Control's Area X is the astral plane, a place accessible via deceptively unassuming altered items and objects of power, common household appliances or other such seemingly normal knickknacks that have inexplicably acquired impressive and unfathomable reality-breaking abilities. The Federal Bureau of Control collects and studies these objects and hides their existence from the public, much as the Southern Reach works to keep the public blissfully unaware of Area X. I'd also be remiss if I didn't mention that the protagonist of the latter two books of the Southern Reach trilogy is often just called Control. Though I won't say he's an analog for Jesse Faden per se, apart from the fact that they're both thrust into positions of leadership at their respective government organizations without fully knowing or understanding the inner workings of said organization. But while Control and the novels of Vandermeer's Southern Reach trilogy both deal in the fantastical and the unknowable, neither compromise their stories by traveling too far down the rabbit hole of the incomprehensible. While the particulars of any given story element may be left without explanation, the narrative as a whole is preserved and propelled by the characters, most of whom approach the mysteries of their stories with a sort of clinical observation. And I think this is the key to keeping Control's mysteries from inadvertently unraveling the greater narrative. Lake and Kasurian have both talked about how, in building the world of the Federal Bureau of Control, they loved the idea of how government bureaucracy would go about studying unknowable phenomena. Amidst all the rules and regulations required to operate a federally funded agency, how would the study of the supernatural look? Well, in Control, it seems almost normal. As Jesse digs further through the piles of documents littered across the oldest house and talks with more and more of the house's residents, she and the player discover that the FBC's approach to the study of the unknown is almost clinical. And I think it's this clinical approach to the supernatural world of Control that makes it so compelling a world to explore. This normalcy is bolstered by a series of taped recordings from the Bureau's Dr. Casper Darling, who, amongst other things, appears to serve as the face of the FBC's employee training program. And thanks largely in part to the magnetic charisma of Alan Wake alum Matthew Peretta, who, while defying the old storytelling adage of show don't tell, makes Dr. Darling's exposition dumps a joy to consume rather than a chore to endure. and Casper Darling, probably more than any other character in Control, is the most nonchalant about the ever-changing and mysterious world of the oldest house. Not only that, but he's truly enthusiastic about his work at the Bureau. At least until he isn't. But if you haven't played Control yet, I won't say anything else about that. But ignoring these latter portions of the story, Dr. Darling's enthusiasm about his work makes the idea of being an employee at the Bureau seem exciting, perhaps even comfortable. Dr. Darling is friendly, jovial, a person you'd want to work with. Sure, the things he's talking about in his tapes are terrifying when given even a moment's thought, but he speaks of them in such a carefree manner. Could they really be all that dangerous? Now, Control treats this exploration of the supernatural like a voyage across an unknown sea. The unknowable is knowable, it just needs to be explored. And for those who would look at the world of Control and see a government agency dealing with fantastical and dangerous supernatural phenomena and think to themselves, I don't see how anyone would ever want to work there, well, just take a look at NASA. The research occurring at the FBC is not all that dissimilar from NASA's missions to set a man on the moon. When President John F. Kennedy threw down the gauntlet and said America would put a man on the moon by the end of the decade, there was still an incredible amount of information about crewed spaceflight that they just didn't know. Whole craft had to be designed and constructed to withstand conditions that were only understood in theory. The surface of the moon was as unknown and alien a place as any humankind had been to before. And yet, knowing the dangers they'd face, people joined the program. They wanted to be a part of something greater. And I think you could argue that the employees of the FBC are analogs to those early recruits at NASA. Control even describes the FBC's explorers of the astral plane as astronauts, cementing that NASA connection even further. Now, the Latin motto of the 13th Apollo mission was Ex Luna Scientia, or roughly, from the moon knowledge. And the FBC could easily change that to from the astral plane knowledge. In Control, the unknown is a wilderness, waiting to be tamed. It's a lock, waiting for the right combination. Facing the unknown is normal. It's brave. It's necessary. It's the job. Hey everybody, this is Jake Theriault with Subpixel. If you've made it this far, hopefully it means you enjoyed that video that you just watched. So if you could leave a like and a comment and subscribe if you're not subscribed already, that lets us and our robot overlords at YouTube know that this video is worth watching. So thank you for that, and we'll see you next time.